Hi, this is John Culler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm on location here in Las Vegas, Nevada. Actually, not too far from the famous Las Vegas sign on the Las Vegas Strip. And we're at the home of El Toro Loco. And I was actually here in 2017, probably December 2017, and filmed a video sharing how Toro is actually growing food in his mobile home. Basically in his backyard, and you can see the backyard's basically fenced off back there. And he's got everything in containers and pots because in the mobile home park, you can't plant things in the ground. It has worked well for him, and he was so excited about gardening way back then. And now I want to see the update, if he's still as excited now. And also, more importantly, I want to share with you guys an update of what his garden looks like now. He's taken on many things in life. He's taken on a microgreens business. He wants to expand and stop working for the man. And he's all over the place, so he does not spend that much time in his garden like he used to. In this episode, you're gonna see his backyard that basically is a no-work garden. He basically hardly does anything to his garden, but the thing he did do right was set it up properly. So you're gonna see how basically, by doing very little work, you could have tons of food to eat if you set it up right. And actually, that's why I'm here. I wanna show you guys how to set your garden up right so that if you do get busy in life and get another job or start a business or do something else, you have kids and you can't be out in your garden, how you could still eat out of your garden and have abundant amounts of food without hardly doing any work after you set it up properly. And we're gonna be sure to share with you guys all the steps you guys need to set up your garden properly. So anyways, let's go ahead in the backyard and show you guys the abundance food that El Toro Loco is growing here in Las Vegas, Nevada. So now we're in the backyard. I'm gonna share with you guys his garden. First of all, I wanna put a link down below to the video and how this garden used to look like back in 2017 when I visited. It is such an amazing difference and change. And if we come back out here, I mean, basically, if we look, this is basically just a wild garden. He set it up properly. He has the irrigation system come on. You know, at this point in time, it's end of April, and it comes on three times a day for a few minutes each time. And provided it comes on and waters everything, he has literally abundant amounts of greens and plants to eat. I mean, over here we got mallow, which is definitely a weed. We've got different kinds of kales and dandelions and chicory and all kinds of crazy stuff. So this is gonna be an invaluable episode for those of you guys that are actually in Las Vegas specifically, because you'll find what will literally reseed on its own. So how this works is basically the plants, you'll let them go to seed and flower. This guy is already flowering. This guy is setting the flowers, and you'll see the mallow already has the flower pods on there, or the seeds actually forming. These little seeds could be eaten when they're nice and green right here. Or if you let them get a little bit more mature, they dry out, and then you could separate them. And these are the little seeds right there. And then basically, he doesn't even collect them. He's so lazy. He just lets them drop. He lets birds eat them. The birds poop, or the wind blows them, and they blow everywhere. Now, the other thing I will say is that he's been really smart. He got busy with his microgreens business. Maybe I'll show that to you in a minute. And he basically grows in coconut coir. And in the coconut coir, he puts all the seeds out. He puts all the used coconut coir after he's done growing the microgreens as the mulch layer on top of his raised beds. And actually, this is how he gets lots of seeds into some of his beds so that they also grow food. So if you don't have a microgreens business, you can just buy seeds and literally, you know, broadcast them out in your garden to grow. But that's a tip that we'll talk about in a little bit. What I want to do first is actually show you guys some of the amazing growth and some of the plants that he's growing using this technique of very little work garden, so that you guys could grow some food and set up beds, you know, so they basically every year they come back year after year growing the same exact crops. So the first crop you definitely want to grow to have unlimited food year round is a wild green. This is one of the most nutritious greens on the planet. It's actually good for a reduction of histamine if you're having histamine issues or maybe allergies. And it's right back here. It's actually called the stinging nettle. This plant will sting you. he drinks it as a tea, but I personally would probably vacuum blend it up. He has so much of it, I would just clear cut all the tops off, even the seeds, rich in essential fatty acids. I would use those. But I mean, I would just, ow, I just got stung. I would just basically pluck off all the tops and pluck off all the nice large leaves, add them to a smoothie with coconut water, bananas, maybe some green powders, and actually some mint. That's actually my smoothie that I make, that I made with all my stinging nettles recently, so you guys could get those into you. Once again, he lets these grow up. He lets the seeds, form. He lets them drop, and then the seeds will drop, and then they'll germinate for next year. But also with the stinging nettles, I found that the roots will stay alive year round, and in the springtime especially, they'll just pop up new growth. All right, so the next bed that actually is probably my favorite bed of his greens that he's growing, I can't even keep this alive year round in Las Vegas because he has a nice place underneath the tree that stays a bit warmer. This guy does not like to freeze, but this guy he has in mass abundance. This stuff is known as longevity spinach or Gianera Procumbens. I think he'd also be good to try the Gianera bicolor, also known as Okinawan spinach, in a more shady spot. But this is just looking so fabulous. I wish I had this much of these guys to grow. This is a perennial green. So unlike the stinging nettles that'll basically grow, drop seeds, this one basically will continue to grow and grow and grow all year round, provided it does not get a freeze. It'll just stay alive. It can handle the heat of the summer, and provided it doesn't freeze or get too cold. Like, it could handle 33 degrees, but it cannot handle 32. And that's why I like to grow it as my favorite tropical perennial green. I mean, they say it's like a cholesterol lowering plant. You know, might lower your cholesterol, but my solution for lowering your cholesterol is not eating Gianera. It is actually not eating the foods that are gonna give you the cholesterol in the first place, which are anything that has a mother. So the next plant that he's growing just basically is taken over as a weed, and actually can be a weed. It's not normally thought of as an edible plant, but it actually is edible. I would call it a medicinal plant. This is actually known as ajuga. I like it because it actually has nice dark purple leaves. And this is probably like, you know, one of the best bitter foods. Now, you don't want to probably eat a lot of this stuff, but it's kind of like dandelion. This stuff is extremely bitter. Bitters are very important for us to eat. They probably are detoxifying and helping us cleanse our livers. But when you eat this, it tastes like the worst cough syrup you've ever eaten. Like, serious, it's like bitter and kind of gross. You wouldn't want to make a salad out of this, but hey, for some medicinal use, probably really good. I got to research it, but the cool thing is, this is actually flowering. So it could pop off some of these like little purple flowers. And I got to try these a little bit earlier today for the first time in my life. And I want you guys and encourage you guys to eat more flowers, right? Flowers have the pollen, which is what the bees collect, so that you could get it secondhand when they collect their bee pollen, and humans steal it from the bees and then we eat it. Could be good for our allergies. In addition, the little flowers at the ends have a little bit of nectar in there. Now, you could taste the nectar, but the hummingbirds like to come around and stick their little beaks in there and get the nectar. If you eat the end, you'll get like a little bit of sweetness. It's kind of like if you ever did that with pineapple sage. So you get a little sweetness of the nectar, but then you get the hit of a milder, bitter green. Oh, and then of course you got the purple anthocyanins, which are in the flowers as well. I mean, these flowers grow on you because it's like kind of sweet, and then it hits you with a bitter. But definitely tastes better than the greens, and he has basically abundance of this stuff year-round. Planted it once, and it took over basically this whole raised bed as an understory. So I like it actually as a ground cover as well. Some of these next plants here are Ikira, and actually this makes an edible kind of like a tuber on the bottom that's rich in starch. And so actually these I gave him, and this will take over the whole raised bed. It's actually doing quite well for him. I don't think he's ever dug them up. They could be eaten like as a, they're known as a famine food, like instead of potatoes. And then over here he has actually daylilies, which actually I really like a lot. And he eats the flowers. So I encourage you guys to grow more edible flowers than the daylilies. I mean, these guys are basically both perennial, and it will come back year after year on their own. So he has, once again, that unlimited wild food that he's searching for. I really like how he doesn't waste any space. Literally in the back of here, he's got these like, I don't know, like old, like steel containers. I don't know what they're used for previously. Some kind of industrial thing he found for cheap on OfferUp, more than likely. But basically he put these and use these as basically little planters. And he has his drip line coming by, and he's growing the mint, right? Mint is best grown in its own little container because it will spread out and take over. But now he has all the, I think it's apple mint, right? So you could just pick it and eat it. Wow. There's definitely good in a smoothie. Eating a mint, hey, I got minty fresh breath if I went on a date tonight. But yeah, I mean, the main thing that I see here personally, and I'll comment on this, like, he has so much food growing, it's insane. He just doesn't harvest it fast enough. So I would harvest, like, oh, I would go around and top all these mints, which would be good because now it's spread up into two and grow more. With the, you know, with the stinging nettles, some coconut water, and some frozen bananas or other frozen, like, you know, wild blueberries from Trader Joe's, and make an amazing smoothie with it. This next bed is completely amazing for me because I haven't had that much luck growing the red Russian kale here in Las Vegas. And surely El Toro Loco has proved me wrong that you could grow it easily and abundantly, because literally there's one bed that's, I don't even know, he literally built it out of like shipping pallets, plastic shipping pallets that were screwed together. It's just unlimited red Russian kale. You know, he could cook the kale up, make kale chips, juice the kale, turn it into smoothies, you know, blend it up and feed it to his dogs. You know, kale is rich in protein. It's also anti-aging and anti-cancer. And to me, this is just not getting harvested enough, but he has so much kale. It's insane. If I had this much kale, I'd be making it into kale chips, dehydrating it as fast as I could make it. Cause I'll tell you, you know, I might not like to eat plain kale that often, but if I had it in kale chips with a little sauce on there, I mean, even an easy kale chip is just kale massaged with oil and salt, which I don't like to eat oil and salt, but if you massage the kale with oil and salt and ate it instead of potato chips or any other kind of chips, it'd still be way healthier than anything else you could eat, and pretty anti-cancer at the same time. Just don't fry your kale. Just dehydrate it in a dehydrator or put it in an oven at a low temperature, like 250 degrees. 300 degrees, lowest as your oven will go, and get it to dehydrate, make it crispy, and make it delicious. Oh my gosh, unlimited red Russian kale. All right, so this is another bed of mint, and this is a full raised bed, I don't know, maybe 4 feet by 4 feet, all mint. It's actually growing a lot better than mine this time of year. He stays a little bit warmer than I do. And I mean, once again, I'd come around and top all this mint and basically make a big mint smoothie out of it. It'd be so delicious. I mean, mint is so amazing. It just smells so good. I mean, it's just densely planted. He waters it. This stuff is just doing so great. And mint is like literally could be a weed in your garden. So you definitely want to take care and grow it in its own raised bed or its own container. This is more of a standard peppermint style mint. What you guys are looking at are water pepper. And I am responsible for this because I gave him water pepper seeds once. They grew and then he basically didn't collect the seeds, let them drop. And look at this, he has a whole, literally, this is his walkway path of water pepper. This would be great to cut back and use as microgreens. I've never usually had this much water pepper. I mean, the ground is moist, so he's definitely watering like a lot. And man, the baby water pepper, like microgreens here. Mmm. So delicious. They're not really that hot and spicy. Well, they are. They're like kind of like a substitute for hot peppers. When the plants get older, they kind of look like this. And normally what I do is I'll just harvest like the tips. You could also harvest the leaves. And it likes to grow in water, although it also handles some dryness as well. Handles the temperatures, no problem. It has also become a weed in my garden. And this stuff is absolutely delicious if you like hot and spicy and you can't wait for your peppers to mature and ripen. You could use this in its place. I think I looked up the health benefits of this also. I think it was good for maybe lowering your blood pressure, but like all these crazy herbs have so many different good medicinal properties if you'd only get them into your diet. I mean, maybe even another way to do this would be make a tea out of this stuff so it really like dilute down the hot and spiciness, but I really like that flavor punch that you get when you eat it. The next vegetable that El Toro has in mass abundance is one of my favorites. It's actually right here. And these guys are extremely long. He must have some really good soil. I've never seen them like this long before. This is known as red vein sorrel, also known as bloody dock. I really love this plant just because it's so, you know, it's got like the, it shows the red veins and it's just so pretty. But also this stuff is completely edible. Kind of tastes like sorrel. And he basically just lets it go to flower and seed. You can see the seeds starting to form here. They drop and then they basically come back in mass abundance. In addition, I found by the sides propagating by the seed, I find that once it does go to seed, you just cut it back at the base and the root ball will stay alive and then come back the following year. So it's kind of like a perennial plant. So this would probably be one of my first choices. Plus it also is rich in the anthocyanins. It's got the red pigment in there. And I like to dehydrate these actually. They kind of have like a nice stronger flavor if you eat them raw, but if you dehydrate them, I found that they actually get kind of like a little bit salty. So that'd be another good one to mix in with the kale to make those kale chips. Or I guess in this case, you could make Bloody Dock chips. That'd be interesting. Another thing that has been very successful at reseeding on its own in El Toro's garden and mine is the celery. You know, I've seen some commonalities, like I'll have some of the same things that keep coming back year after year, although his garden looks a bit more abundant than mine. But he has basically unlimited celery. You know, you grow the celery normally for the stalks that are like, you know, almost like white in the grocery store. But if you harvest the celery, like the whole stems, when they're nice and green and more baby, you can eat those and they're a lot more stronger flavored. I would surmise that they're a lot more healthy in this method, in this way, than getting the ones that are overinflated, just grown for the stems. And of course, you could also eat the greens of the celery, but they're a lot more stronger. Excellent to use in soups. And he has all these baby ones coming up as seed, but if we just back up, you can see the, you know, some of the mother plants are right here and they're huge. They're going to complete flower and seed. And even when they're like this, you could juice these thick stalks in like a horizontal auger juicer. I've done that before, but I'll tell you, the juice is actually very medicinal at that point. And you guys may or may not be familiar with the medical medium who encourages you guys to drink like celery juice every day. I think like 8 to 16 ounces. You could do some damage with this celery, man. It'd be extremely strong, so you might not even want to do that much. The next plant that's done really well for El Toro Loco as well as me, that comes back year after year in my garden also, is the Swiss chard. You guys can see it's like taller than me, like towering over 6 feet, but yet he still has all the nice Swiss chard leaves down below. I was looking up Swiss chard the other day, and actually I found that the Swiss chard is actually higher in omega-6 fatty acids than most leafy greens, which are more omega-3 dominant. These are actually omega-6 dominant, which is actually quite rare. It's very important to get a right omega-3 to 6 balance, but it's highly unlikely you're gonna unbalance yourself from eating too many Swiss chard leaves. You're probably gonna unbalance yourself from eating things like oils and processed food, not Swiss chard. So eat as much Swiss chard as you can. My parents love it, like cooked up in the Instapot. I'll put a link down below to that video. So I've been actually cooking my Swiss chard up for them. It's high in oxalates, but you know, if you eat oxalates on a regular basis and not too larger quantities and you have a good digestive system, I personally don't think that's an issue myself. And this basically will go to reseed on its own. Here's some of the seeds. And this one is very interesting. Once it goes to flower like it is now and setting seed, if you smell it, it has a very, I would say, peculiar or unique like smell to it. So if you walk out to your garden and start smelling kind of weird, make sure you smell your Swiss chard, because that's probably it. All right, so the next plant I would encourage you guys to grow actually is actually this guy. And actually, I wish I had some like this. This is actually the red stem dandelion, or also known as the chicory. I mean, if you go to Whole Foods, which is actually not too far away from here, they'll sell you a bunch of this stuff for, I don't know, $3. But this stuff really grows like a weed and is one of those plants that'll come back year after year for you without any issue if you plant it just once. You know, so he's planted it, and you guys can see the dandelion here. When it goes to flower, it gets taller, and you can see here, it's starting to go to flower and will set seeds. It's also related to lettuce. But I love this plant so much, and you could, you know, the whole plant is usable. You could use the stalks, you could use the greens, and you could also use the roots. I have a video once where I actually juiced dandelion roots, and that stuff was quite strong. So you guys saw what El Toro Loco is growing here in Las Vegas, that depending on where you live, may or may not work for you. I'd say they're probably gonna work in most places, because these plants tend to be kind of seedy and weedy and will reproduce without your intervention. But more importantly, if you have a barren backyard desert in Las Vegas, which is what most places are, they're not gonna reseed on their own. So you need to create a healthy ecosystem literally in your backyard to support life, to support the seeds being, the plants being healthy enough to basically reseed on their own, drop the seeds, and then the seeds feeling comfortable enough to basically germinate, sprout, and grow you more food with very little work on your parts. I mean, that's what's been happening here. That's why I could barely walk through some of this backyard, because it's just so overgrown. He does not take care of it, even like stake things up or pin it together. It's just wild. And it's cool and wild back here, you know, as compared to like the strip where everything's neat and tidy and all this stuff. But anyways, to set up a proper ecosystem in your backyard, you're gonna need to do a few things, and that's the most important part of this episode is this, because I want you guys to do this, whether you guys wanna have a weedy garden and a very easy, food that you're growing, or whether you wanna have a productive garden and actually you're gonna manage it and take care of it a little bit more, you wanna do these steps because they're literally foundational, all right? So the first step is you wanna have some kind of good containers to grow your food in. So I mean, he has many different containers, some kind of like 15 gallon pots, some smaller pots that tend to dry out here in the heat. He has some raised beds, like this raised bed is at least 18 inches tall. He has some raised beds that are made out of, pallets that are like 3 feet tall, you know, so that's very important. You wanna have a good sufficient quantity of good soil. You know, he brought in some really good compost, local compost, and he's been amending the compost with things like rock dust and worm castings, all the cool things that I talk about, and he's built up a very good soil microbiome. So the first thing is, you know, have good raised beds that have an opportunity to put a lot of soil. Second thing is have the best soil. This is not an episode about going into creating healthy soil. I have whole episodes on that, but you want to get the best soil you can, and then after you get the best soil you can, then you want to make sure you put in a good irrigation system that comes on automatically. So you can see here, he's literally got the jumbo size irrigation tubing that actually I don't even use, that I probably should have put in. This is like 3/4 inch irrigation drip tubing. I usually use a 1/2 inch. This allows his irrigation to have really excellent pressure. And then he has emitters that will basically emit, and actually instead of drippers, he has basically the little sprinkler things, which actually I think I might convert over to, because you get a better spread of the water. And actually I think that's one of the keys that he's doing here, that actually I'm not doing, that I think I'm gonna maybe experiment with this year to see if I could get better, you know, water spread, because the drippers drip down. This kind of has like a little sprouting out and makes a whole wet area, which is a lot better for making a better environment for your plants. So talking about water, and while the irrigation system is critical, it's even more critical to use the best water you can. So he basically has city water here that's included in one low price at the mobile home park, which is amazing. And but he also is very smart about it. He put in probably one of the best filter systems you guys could get. The water comes in here and it basically goes to his irrigation right here. He could turn this off, and he put in this is called a big blue filter. This is actually the 10 inch big blue filter, but I would recommend you guys get a 20 inch big blue filter. He basically just sunk this down into the ground, and it looks like he probably needs to change the filter pretty soon. He probably hasn't done it in a while. But basically you can get a carbon/KDF filtration media to remove out that chlorine or the chloramine out of the water that is in their design to kill the bad bugs, you know, and the bacteria, so that we don't get, you know, water outbreaks of cryptosporidium and giardia and all these things, right? But those chlorine could basically kill your microbes so that you could have a healthy garden. So I really like that he's done this, and he's taken my advice that I actually haven't even done yet. He's put in the big blue filter, and I just have like these hose end filters, so I need to definitely upgrade my game. All right, so the big advantage El Toro Loco has that you probably won't have is actually he has a microgreens business where he delivers to restaurants and sells microgreens to the local area. This is just some of the microgreens he's growing right now. But how does this benefit his garden? Well, basically what happens is he grows the microgreens. He uses the coconut coir right here, which is basically his soilless growing medium, so that he grows the best microgreens with it. That goes down in the tray. And then he puts the seeds on top, and he has seeds in mass abundance. He has big 5-gallon buckets of seeds. He has little containers of seeds. This happens to be blue kale seeds. He buys seeds in mass bulk because you have to put a lot of seeds down to get really nice, thick microgreens like this that are nice, thick, and dense, right? He then will then harvest the microgreens after about 10 to 14 days, just chop them up and then sell them. And then he basically has these flats that have the coconut coir with the ungerminated seeds, right? He will then take these as he gets them and takes it out to his garden and dumps them out so that he doesn't waste this valuable resource of basically unsprouted seeds and the coconut coir that he uses to benefit his garden. So let's go outside and show you guys how this benefits his garden. You guys can see in this garbage can, he basically has all the spent microgreens, like the stuff he's cut, also the coconut coir, and there's lots of still ungerminated seeds. So literally, he'll spread it out in the top of his garden beds, basically, to cover it. So this does a few things. Number one, it mulches. This is used as a mulch. It covers the soil to protect the soil, but also more importantly, he's literally putting down thousands of unsprouted seeds in his garden. Of course, the greens will break down and actually provide nutrients and food for the microbes, which is great. So he's feeding his microbes, also putting out seeds that then will germinate and then grow into this garden. I mean, that's literally how easy it is. Now, if you don't have the benefit of having the coconut coir and the seeds in there, check with a local microgreens grower that has to get rid of their, you know, seed mats and their, you know, coconut coir every week as they harvest. Maybe you could get it and then spread that out in your garden. If you guys can't do that, then you could just buy the seeds in bulk, right? And you could just throw them out in your garden and use some coconut coir virgin to cover it with. The coconut coir is fairly inexpensive, right? I'm gonna have some good videos coming up with the best coconut coir I found, you know, that's you know, properly washed and all this stuff. And then just have your irrigation system come on. It waters it, it grows, let plants go to flower and seed. That's the other thing he does. Let some droplets, nature do their work. Nature knows what to do. We try to get in the way too much and control nature too much. He just lets things go wild. I mean, you can see here, here's some arugula. The arugula is sprouting, it's germinating. The arugula is flowering, it's creating little seed pods. And look at this. They're getting eaten by the birds, right? The birds are eating the seeds, but at the same time, the birds are pecking these open, right? They also spread the seeds. The seeds will drop and then germinate, right? So you gotta make sure you get that part of the system right, because if you don't let things go to seed, like most farmers or gardeners would harvest things well before they go to seed, you're not gonna have a garden that you could do little work on that'll be this abundant with food. So I think the last thing I wanna do in this episode, actually, we're gonna go ahead and interview El Toro Loco and get his take on his crazy garden and all the food he's growing. So now here with El Toro Loco, and you guys saw his amazing wild garden that basically does almost no work on these days. So we're gonna ask him some questions about his gardening style, you know, how his gardening style has evolved and why isn't he putting more work in his garden and all these crazy things. All right, so El Toro, why don't you like spend a lot of time in your garden these days?
I'm just busy, man. It takes care of itself. You know, I'm a big fan of working smarter and not harder. And when you work with nature, it does all the work for you.
That's exactly it, man. So the other thing I want to say is, dude, where'd you get, like, if you guys saw the original shirt, like, check out his shirt. Dude,
yeah,
it's so crazy.
Buddy.
Do you think that looks like me?
Yeah. Most people's heroes is money, fast food, and bad addictions. But mine is this guy, because he changed my life for the better. And here I am today, and look at this garden. This garden is worth millions.
He has literally more food than he can eat, or does eat.
Yep.
So on a weekly basis, man, how many hours, honestly, do you put into your garden to do anything?
Some weeks, zero. Literally, I don't even come out here at all.
Like the harvest stuff? You don't even harvest stuff to eat?
No, because I have the microgreens. I'm spoiled.
He eats microgreens instead because they're more nutritious.
Yeah, they're a lot easier to deal with. I don't have to deal with the elements.
See, for me, microgreens are harder to deal with. I'd rather just go outside and pick some greens for my garden, man. It's way easier.
I mean, I do that when I feel like doing it. And when I decide to do that, I have so much food, it's in abundance. Like, sometimes I just come out here and marvel at what I've created. Because, you know, I had the knowledge to do it. So knowledge without works is, you know, it's just like knowledge without faith is dead.
Yeah, dude, it's amazing what you've created here, and that, like, you know, you could be an inspiration for so many people out there that, like, want to have lots of food, but they have a job and they can't. I mean, you got a regular job, too. You got a regular job. You got your microgreens business, trying to start another business. You got a huge garden. Oh, my gosh. You got dogs that can take care of, a girlfriend to deal with. Your time is limited. So you, like, learn how to grow the food, you know, watching my videos and also experimenting on your own. What are some tips you want to give some of my viewers right now that want to set up a garden pretty much like yours? Like, what are the most important things that they want to focus on?
Well, you know, you just gotta basically take your style, whatever your style is in life, however extravagant or minimalism that you would have adapted to, you want to take those things and apply it to what your style of garden would be like. You may not know what that is, but just like, you know, just how you live your everyday lifestyle. You know, if you're somebody who likes to take their time doing something, do it that way. Do it your way. There's no rules or regulations as to how you need to set up a garden. So just, you know, vibe off your own personality. Know what kind of person you are, and just work with your own self so that you don't get discouraged. You don't feel burdened like it's too much work. I mean, I did this just slowly over time, and now I just look at what I've created. It's just crazy. So that's the advice I give to people. You know, always think positive, and, you know, think of what you will accomplish at the end of the day. Not so much the trials and tribulations that you have to deal with getting to the point where you want to be. It'll all be worth it in the end. And just know that, you know, always have a goal. Whether it's having the baddest bed garden that you possibly can have, or setting up like a really cool microgreen farm in the corner of a room that and free up some space to do that. I actually recommend going the microgreens route if you can, because to me it's a lot easier and it's a lot more of a sterile, simple process. And they're actually more nutritious than anything I have out here that's grown wild, just because of the concentrated amounts of nutrition that is in the baby green that you are putting into your body. And then you can be really versatile with microgreens. I do blends. I do a 7 blend called the Rainbow Blend, which is 7 different microgreens. I believe I'm the only grower out here locally in Vegas that does that. So that's like my thing. I'm known as the blend guy. And yeah, some people may look at it as being a lot of work, which it is. And I've just gotten used to it. So it's like not as bad for me anymore to deal with that. So yeah, just basically go at your own pace. And that's my advice. You know, don't think of it like, man, it's gonna take me so long, I'm lazy, this and that. So what? You can be lazy in the garden. Just do what you want to do. And if you feel like only working 5 minutes, so what? You know, at least you're moving in the right direction. You know, you are worth it. He has said it so many times in the videos. You could have $1 trillion, but if you have poor health, what good is all that money gonna do for you? I would rather have this garden than a lot of money. As long as I have access to water, I will always be able to feed myself with nutritious food that's gonna give me, you know, a better mind, better longevity, better overall energy, everything. You know, the benefits of just being able to like have a place to, you know, de-stress. I come out here and I just sit down and just totally just the greenery around me just puts me in a tranquil state. And even if, you know, you don't want to grow food, it doesn't matter, it doesn't mean anything. You could still, you know, put together you know, plants that you like just because you like plants, and use, you know, a garden or a space to create that de-stressing environment that we all need so much in today's fast-paced society, where there's so much information and the focus is money all the time. It's really quite unfortunate. The focus should be nutrition and health, and then money should come secondary to that. So yeah, that's just basically, you know, one of my rants about how I feel about, you know, the current state of the world that we live in. And, you know, we really need to get back to nature. There's so much information out there now on how to live a more healthy, clean lifestyle. When I got into gardening, one thing I noticed is I started to care a lot more about Mother Earth. And I'm a recycling maniac. I'm obsessed with recycling. No matter how small a little piece of plastic is, I want to leave the lightest footprint on Earth that I possibly can. I take out my trash maybe once every 3-4 months. It takes me that long to fill up a trash bin because I'm so focused on not creating more pollution on this Earth, not creating more trash. And having a garden also allows you to do that. It helps the environment so much with, you know, they haul in this food from California in semis, and, you know, it's so bad for the environment. And also, a lot of the food that you get, the gardeners are looking at the bottom line and the money and the profit they can make from the leafy greens that they're selling you, instead of focusing on soil biology. And that's something that I have total control of in my garden. I, you know, for my microgreens, I get the coir with mycorrhizae already in it, so that way it's easier for the seeds to sprout in my garden. And I've had a lot of good success with topping off my beds with the coco coir. I top off my beds more with coco coir than I do with organic compost now, just because I hate being wasteful, and I'm just, you know, I'll always be that way. I think it's just getting worse with age. So I'm like a recycling hoarder, if you want to call me that. Besides the being a plant hoarder, as you can see,
All right, cool, man. That was such an amazing rant, and I would definitely agree with you, man. Like, we should be number one. Like, you know, we are job number one, or you are job number one. You know, not your job to is, you know, that we dedicate 40 hours a week to our job so that we can make money, but then we dedicate, you know, 2 hours on making healthy food for us to eat. Instead, we get fast food or junk food, right? You're not, you know, and if you don't have you, you can't work at your job. So it's like, but we're like taught like, oh, money and a job is the most important thing. But no, you're the most important thing. So I want you guys to put yourself first. And what you guys don't know about El Toro Loco is that he was a competitive eater before he started gardening and he changed his life. So you want to talk about some of the benefits you've gotten from growing your own food and eating healthier, well, from being a competitive eater, man? Well, and
one of the benefits from being a competitive eater is I enjoy eating one meal a day, which is also known as an OMAD diet. So having a larger capacity than normal allows me to get in 12 to 15 cups of organic leafy greens or cruciferous vegetables as a base of my meal. And then with that, I do healthy fats. And then unfortunately, I don't have access to kill or slaughter my own animals, which is what he recommends you do if you do eat meat. So I eat grass-fed, grass-finished, organic-fed beef when I do put meat into my body, or I'll do wild-caught as a protein, like wild-caught salmon or shrimp, which he definitely does not recommend doing. That's just what I do because it works for me. I like to do healthy keto. It's known as healthy keto. That's eliminating all seed oils, which are actually toxic. The factories that they make canola, corn, vegetable oil in look like nuclear waste plants. They're so toxic. They create so many diseases. Science has proven it and shown it. It's only getting worse. People go to, you go like anywhere around town in Vegas, every drive-through In-N-Out is loaded up. From when they open to when they close, that's absolutely sickening. I have no cars in front of my home buying microgreens off me, or people trying to buy my organic leafy greens. And that's a travesty. It really should be the other way around. The blends I put together are absolutely amazing, and I feel good. People that, the small circle of people that buy from me, love them. They say they feel better when they eat them, and they feel better knowing that, you know, they're buying from you think you're ever gonna meet Elon Musk if you buy Tesla from him? No, but you can meet me if you buy microgreens from me, and I can tell you, I'll answer all your questions because I'm living it. And you know, I'm not in this for the money. I enjoy doing the microgreen thing because it allows me to eat more microgreens in an easy way, because I'm not just growing them for me to eat, I'm growing them to supply the community with them. So it's like one of the perks of the job. It's the best perk in the world. Because I never get tired of eating microgreens or even leafy greens from the garden. The possibilities of the billions of kinds of juices you can put together, and you could just, if you're not creative, you can learn to be creative in making juices, and you find out what you really like and what works for you, and then just go off that. And it'll, you know, anything you have to do, any kind of strategy you can formulate to be able to make sure that you live a healthier lifestyle, do it. I'm all for it. And so is this guy. If you're watching this video now, I'm sure you've seen other videos of his, and what he preaches is the best thing that you could possibly do while you're on this planet for the short time that we are here. That's taking care of Mother Earth and taking care of your own health by working with Mother Nature to accomplish the ultimate goal of everyone is longevity. We all want to live a long, healthy lifestyle. I just want to pass away in my sleep is the best thing. And like he preaches, he wants to live a fulfilled life. And that's why he's the real deal, this guy. We tried to take him to a vegan restaurant years ago. He wasn't having it because he preaches good, better, best, and he could get way better food out of his own garden than we could ever buy at any restaurant, especially because he knows his own soil practices. And I could go on and on and on. You guys catch what we're saying and what we're preaching. And, you know, it's all for the better of Earth, yourself, your family, and everything else. I said it in the last video. I'm saying it now. The goal never changes. It's always, you know, peace, love, happiness, and longevity.
And reproduction.
Reproduction.
Or at least well. Practicing.
That's healthy, too. It actually keeps you looking young, feeling young.
Right on, man. So I definitely would agree. I mean, I'm microgreens deficient unless I come here and he hooks me up, get some good microgreens here in Las Vegas. I definitely would, recommend him. For his microgreens, those are the ones that I eat, and they're definitely top grade because he harvests them fresh, gets them right out to you guys. But I want to correct him on something. So you know, I definitely would agree that microgreens are more nutritious than garden grown vegetables. But the other thing I've learned is that diversity is really the king. As much as they're more nutritious, right? We want it, and he grows in a more sterile environment, although he doesn't, you know, have some, he does have some mycorrhizae and some other maybe beneficial microbes in his microgreens. There's so much a bigger collection of microbes out in his backyard garden that will have an influence on us when we eat it. Plus the fiber is different, you know, I'm confident, from microgreens to like stalk, thick stalks of celery, right? The fiber is different, and different fibers feed our microbiome. In addition, you know, unless he's growing microgreens of every different plant he's growing in the backyard, the nutrients are gonna be different, you know? So you can't say, instead of eating, you know, full-grown stinging nettle, I'm gonna eat broccoli because they're the same nutrition, or broccoli's been better. Well, in some ways broccoli's better, but in some ways the stinging nettle out in the backyard are better. Even in some ways, the red Russian kale microgreens are better than the big tall microgreens, but in some ways the big plants are better than the small ones. So it's good to have like a more wide open kind of like you know, mentality, in my opinion, to be inclusive of all different kinds of foods in different forms. And the most important thing I will say is diversity. You want to grow diversity in your garden, like I've shown you today that El Toro Loco is doing in his backyard, growing all different kinds of plants. He doesn't have just one thing. He has all kinds of crazy stuff happening. In addition, you know, he has a microgreens blend. Unlike most microgreens places that sell like one microgreen, he'll blend all these microgreens up. So it's a diversity, which is great. He also grows a diversity in his garden. And I would encourage him to eat more diversity in his life. Make a microgreens slash, like celery greens smoothie. You know, harvest some chickweed that I'm literally sitting on top of. Put it into the smoothie with the microgreens. That'll boost the microgreen smoothie even better, because it'll have things that the microgreen smoothie does not. All right, it's kind of getting dark and I gotta run to the next thing I'm doing. But El Toro Loco, if somebody wants to buy your microgreens or get a hold of you, how can they get a hold of you, get some of your amazing microgreens? And maybe if somebody wants to buy some of your greens, maybe you'll sell those too. How can they contact you, man?
So you can just find me on IG, Loco Sano Greens. And then just message me on there. I'm also Toro Loco _ on IG. I have two accounts on there. And he'll put the links to my IG
down below.
And you can contact me just like that. And, you know, we could chop it up and, you know, do a deal. I have a business license, LLC. I have a producer certificate from the Department of Agriculture. I am totally legit. And I have all the credentials I need to sell you greens. And I'm doing everything the right way, including, you know, using only organic practices. I am hardcore super organic back here in everything that I do when it comes to gardening or growing microgreens.
And I could vouch for him for sure, because I've checked out his stuff and he's got only clean stuff that I would approve of as well. So El Toro, is there any final words or of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers, to drop on some people today to get them to make their life better?
Keep watching his videos, because of the knowledge that he possesses. He is the gardening master. In the last video I talked about, there's no such thing as a master gardener, because my idea of that is a little bit different than most people's. My idea of a master gardener is somebody who memorizes every single herb, vegetable, and fruit on planet Earth that is edible, and what like the optimal soil conditions for each and every single one of those things is, which is unrealistic, because no human can do that. God can do that, of course, but just the fact that, you know, with experience, you will naturally become by default a master gardener. I was wrong in the last video when I was talking trash about master gardeners. No, they do exist. He's one of them. I'm getting there, and you know, with the experience, like I said, by default, you will become a master gardener. And it's a good feeling to have enough knowledge to be able to talk with any gardening expert. I could talk with this guy for hours about, soil biology, and I know about like 12 different badass amendments to soil, and I learned those things from watching his videos, and I apply them into my garden, not as much as I'd like to, but I have the knowledge to do it when I see fit. And I still have different goals that I want to accomplish, and we all should have goals in life. And you know, I encourage everyone to have a goal of growing your microgreens, sprouts, or have a garden. And you know, make it a family thing where you can come together as a group of people that love each other, that live under the same roof, or even a family that lives nearby, and make it a project for you guys to work together. You know, get your hands dirty. When's the last time you got your hands dirty with soil, organic soil, got it on your knees and really worked in with nature? I'm sure not a lot of people can say that they do that often. Once you have something set up like this, you know, you could do that whenever you choose to, and just better yourself, better your life.
Right on, man. Well, I want to correct him. Like, I am not a master gardener. I never went to school. I mean, they have master gardener programs you could go through to get that title.
You would get an A+.
I don't know about that, because I would disagree with some of the things they teach in the master gardening thing. But thank you for saying that. But what I would say is this, you know, I would say that I know a lot more than most people on gardening, because literally I've applied myself. I've learned from many people along my journeys, my travels. I share that on YouTube for you guys. I've also had my own experiences gardening, you know, a lot more than most people. So I'm kind of becoming more well-rounded, and, you know, and this is what I share with you guys so that you guys can become a more proficient gardener and more successful gardener, which is more important to me than any title of just being a master gardener. You know, what's in a title, right? I want to just show me, not tell me, right? So anyways, that's pretty much it for this episode. If you guys enjoy this episode at El Toro Locos, be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else you could think it could help, so they could grow a really low work or almost no work garden once you set it up properly. And also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that come in every 5 to 7 days. You don't know worship or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes, including the episode I made here in 2017, posted January 1st, 2018. Link down below. You'll trip out, because that's a lot different than it is now, let me tell you. So my other videos are also a wealth of knowledge, over 1500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, going deep into all aspects so you guys can grow your own healthy food at home in the best ways possible. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.